What is going on, everybody? Welcome back to another Detroit Lions video. Now, week two of OTAs is officially in the books for the Detroit Lions. And just like week one, today we are going to be going over the biggest takeaways from whether it be Jared Goff, the offense, the defense, the new coaching staff, or anything else notable from the second week of OTAs. Before we get into taking a second look at this early Detroit Lions roster and early Detroit Lions team, if you're new to the channel and you're enjoying the content, please consider liking the videos and subscribing to the channel. It takes just 2 seconds out of you to do so. It's quick, free, and easy, and you'd be helping the channel out more than you could possibly know. So if you could do that, take those 2 seconds to like and subscribe. I'd be greatly appreciative for it. But with all that being said, without any further ado, let's get into these week two takeaways from the Lions' second week of OTAs. Now, first and foremost, the biggest takeaway, or one of the biggest takeaways from this week of training for our Detroit Lions, has been the play and the level of play from our new quarterback in Mr. Jared Goff. Now, Jared Goff, as I said last week, as we talked about last week, has really been the biggest question mark, or one of the biggest question marks from this offseason, right? The trade for Jared Goff, the trade of Matthew Stafford for Jared Goff, 2 firsts and a 3rd, is a trade that went over very well with both sides of the Lions and Rams franchises and fan bases respectively. However, the biggest question mark in that trade was Jared Goff. How well is he going to play? How well can he manage this Lions offense? How well is he going to do without Sean McVay and without being in a Sean McVay system? And can he help the Detroit Lions exceed expectations and be a better quarterback and make the Lions a better football team than many are expecting them to be? Well, if you are a fan of Jared Goff, or if you are hoping for Jared Goff to be the savior and one of the big time playmakers and players for this Lions franchise next year, you are in luck. Because early in OTAs, both last week and this week, Jared Goff has looked incredibly sharp in 7-on-7, as well as scripted drills over and over again. Jared Goff, especially on Thursday was his biggest day in 7-on-7s, looked incredibly promising and looked very, very sharp, delivering a deep touchdown pass early to Breshad Perriman, as well as connecting multiple times with TJ Hockenson, DeAndre Swift, Tyrell Williams, as well as Elise Mack on every level of the field. So he was connecting with them both short range, medium range, as well as deep down the field. At every level of the field, every single kind of throw you could ask him to make, Jared Goff has been putting them on the money. Dan Campbell has been saying that Jared Goff has been making just some absolute wild throws, some throws that you just look at and say, that is truly undefendable. Perfect throw, perfect placement, everything that you need the quarterback to do. And that's always been one of Jared Goff's strong suits. Jared Goff has always been an incredibly talented quarterback. Jared Goff has always been a guy with a big arm, with some really good accuracies, and his real big struggles in the NFL have kind of been more of the mental side of the game, reading post-snap defenses, you know, making the right decision and making the right throw. You know, of course, he can get the throw there, he can put the throw in the good spot, but was it the right throw to make to begin with? That's always been Jared Goff's biggest problems, or at least that's seemingly what it has been to me. So Jared Goff's arm talent has never really been his struggle. It's never really been a point of emphasis where teams can attack that and really use that to their advantage. However, Jared Goff, from a decision-making standpoint, from a talent standpoint, from an accuracy standpoint, an arm strike standpoint, so far in 7-on-7s and throughout the entirety of OTAs, has looked incredibly solid and incredibly sharp for the Detroit Lions, which is really, really good for him, especially for him going in to the preseason and getting closer to preseason and, of course, eventually the regular season as well, where all the answer or where all the questions will eventually be answered. Now, getting on to the next point of emphasis, this was another news article, another piece of news to come out of OTAs this week, and it is a guy in Victor Bolden. It is a news article. It is a little bit of a story about Victor Bolden, a very under-talked about wide receiver in this wide receiver room. Now, Victor Bolden is a guy that has been a practice squad player, borderline practice squad guy for the past couple of years for the Detroit Lions. However, in this year's OTAs, it has been said that he is both competing for the kick return and punt return spot, as well as a potential slot wide receiver position, and looking to get playing time as a slot wide receiver for the Detroit Lions. Now, Victor Bolden has been told that Victor Bolden is making a lot of plays in the slot. He's made a couple really nice catches, made a really good sliding grab a couple days ago, and has really been getting the attention and grabbing the attention of both wide receivers receivers coach Antoine Randle-Ella, as well as head coach Dan Campbell, and of course offensive coordinator Anthony Lynn is probably not very far behind. I've heard that Victor Bolden Jr. is making a lot of plays in training camp. He's making a lot of plays in OTA so far, and you could be a guy who could be a dark horse candidate to get some time at slot receiver. Of course, right now in the preseason, that role has kind of been given to Amon-Ra St. Brown, but Amon-Ra St. Brown is by no means the guaranteed player at that slot wide receiver position, and you could see Victor Bolden early in the season or in preseason get some time at that slot receiver spot. And when he does, watch out, because he's been making a lot of plays so far for the Lions. Now, another big piece of news to come out, and I think the biggest piece of news overall for the team, has been the way that these OTAs have been constructed and the way that these OTAs are being ran and the way that these players are going about these training sessions with their new coach and with their new teammates and coaching staff and all of that. Now, I think one of the biggest things that the Lions are trying to integrate into their new culture, and I think one of the biggest things that Dan Campbell is trying to bring about when rebuilding this Lions team in his own image, is going to be competition, excitement, adrenaline, and playing hard every single play for 60 minutes. Now, with that being said, that has been very reminiscent of what we are seeing in OTAs, right? Dan Campbell's vision for this team, playing fast, being aggressive, being mean, and playing with a lot of passion and a lot of heart, and being incredibly competitive and having a ton of competition, that, you know, mindset that he had for this team is really coming to fruition in these early OTA trainings. I've heard that these training camps have been very physical. These OTAs have been very physical for players. There's been a lot of really, really good play. Every single player is competing. Every player is giving 100% every single rep. There are not a lot of plays where you see anybody taking anything off the gas. You're not seeing them take their foot off the gas. You're not seeing them hit the brakes. You were seeing 100% go, go, go all the time. They are putting a lot of emphasis on 7-on-7. They are putting a lot of emphasis on competition. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter if you're Frank Ragnow, if you're Jared Goff, if you're Jeff Okuda, or, you know, if you're a backup guy like Mike Ford, who's not expected to maybe get as much playing time. It doesn't matter who you are. Dan Campbell is breeding that competition. He is a guy that has installed a lot of competition and a lot of competitive nature within these OTAs so far, and he is giving everybody a chance to compete and giving everybody a chance to earn playing time and earn a potential starting role come 2021. Victor Bolden, the guy that we talked about earlier, is a perfect example of that. However, with the, you know, of course, with these OTAs being so competitive, with them being so fast-paced and so competitive and exciting and all of that, with so much emphasis being on competition and physicality, there have been a couple of days here and there, and there have been some certain segments throughout OTAs where the Lions have taken some steps back, where they've slowed it down a little bit, and they've gone over things like fundamentals, right? Footwork, tackling, you know, looking the ball in and not just like looking up the field before you catch it, you know, stuff like that. The fundamentals and the small little details that are going to help this team be successful come 2021. Now, of course, Matt Patricia put a ton of emphasis on fundamentals when he was here. However, I think his big thing was just the way he built the team wasn't very good. He didn't get 100% out of his players. His players didn't necessarily want to be there. So even though they were going over fundamentals, it wasn't really being drilled into them as much, because I truly think that the players gave up, and I don't think the players really cared enough to play hard for Matt Patricia or really take, you know, these fundamental trainings into account and really, like, you know, work hard even in the slower parts of practice, even in the trainings where you're getting the fundamentals down, like footwork and hand placement and stuff like that. I don't think the players last year really took that to heart as well as they're going to this year, because they didn't have that respect for Matt Patricia. They didn't really want to play or fight for him or learn for him like they're going to do and like they're seeming to do for Dan Campbell. So although the Lions have had incredible competition, although their practices have been very fast paced and a lot of competition and 7-on-7 drills have been a big part of this training camp or this OTA as well, there is a lot of moments, there are a lot of times in this OTA where they are taking a step back, they are slowing it down a little bit, having a little bit of a slower pace practice or a slower pace segment where our players, our defensive backs, our offensive line, you know, stuff like that, pretty much everybody is going through fundamentals and they are kind of getting better and they're refining their techniques, as well as, you know, of course, having that competition. And then they're putting those fundamentals to use on the field when things get ramped back up and when they go back into 7-on-7 training. Now, the cornerbacks for this Detroit Lions team have also shown a lot of improvement this year as well. Throughout OTAs this year, throughout OTAs so far, throughout the 2 weeks, Jeff Okuda, Amani Oruwariye, as well as Tracy Walker have looked very good, very comfortable, and have looked to take a couple of steps, not just one or two, but taken significant steps forward and significant significant strides in becoming better football players, better secondary members, and better teammates. You know, Tracy Walker has said multiple times, he's come out and said that he feels more free, he feels way better, and feels way more comfortable in the new role that Aaron Glenn is giving him in the defense. Jeff Okuda and Amani Oruwariye pop up almost every single day, making some really nice diving catches, making a really nice extended catches, or just having some really nice plays where they lay out and get some pass defenses, get some pass breakups, and really have some good pass deflections. Like, I've heard a lot of really good things about this secondary so far. I've heard Jeff Okuda has made a lot of plays so far. I've heard Amani has made a couple splash plays. And of course, Tracy Walker has come out multiple times saying that he feels way more comfortable and way more confident in his new role in this new defense than he ever did under Matt Patricia. And you know, that's, you know, a lot of people are going to say, okay, that's great. You know, that's great that they're developing. But I think what's even more impressive about this is that this is on 7-on-7. So there isn't really a whole lot of pressure for Jared Goff. There isn't really an offensive line or a defensive line, you know, getting pressure. And there's nothing to disrupt Jared Goff's throws or the quarterback's throws when he's making them. It's just simply the cornerbacks versus the wide receivers. It's the secondary versus the receiving corps. So the fact that Jared Goff has time in the pocket, of course, he has time. He has no pressure to make the throw or anything like that. And it's simply just really a one-on-one, you versus the other guy, and that our secondary is still making plays, which is something they struggled to do a season ago, is more encouraging than anything else. And I think once that defensive line gets added in, once all that pressure starts getting to the quarterback, you're going to see even more strides being made as preseason rolls around, as they kind of get into more physical, more contact-based drills, and as the offensive and defensive lines really ramp up and they really get into their version and their competitions throughout training camp as that approaches. And of course, as they get the pads moving, as they get the pads back on, and as they start to get more physical throughout the future and throughout, you know, the upcoming weeks of training camp and the rest of OTA. Now, the last thing that I wanted to talk about is just a couple other standout guys. Of course, we talked about the secondary. We've talked about Jared Goff. You know, Elise Mack got some playing time as well. He's got some good reps. He's got some good reps in training camp. We talked about Victor Bolden. But there have been a couple other guys that I wanted to mention. Players that are having really outstanding OTAs. Players that are looking very good, very versatile, and looking like they can have big impacts for this Lions team this year. So the standout players from this week, of course, Jared Goff was one of them. Of course, you have Amon-Ra St. Brown. I've heard is also having a very good week and having a lot of really good reps at OTAs, showing versatility and showing a ton with his skill set that can be used very well for the Detroit Lions. I have heard Elise Mack has been making some plays. He's been finding some targets from Jared Goff. Of course, we talked about him in the 7-on-7 segment. He's been getting some targets and some looks for Jared Goff, so he could be that second or third tight end behind Hockenson and Darren Fells. I have heard that Tracy Walker, we've talked about him, he's getting more comfortable and is looking really good in his new role at safety. And I've also heard that the coaches are very impressed with Ifeti Melifonwu being on the field with his size, his length, and his athleticism, has been making some nice plays as well at multiple spots. They've talked about his versatility. They've talked about his length, his strength, and his speed, and his ability to just get his hands on the football. The coaches have been talking about that recently as well. So those are kind of the standout players this week of OTAs. Jared Goff has had a great week. Amon-Ra St. Brown has had a great week. Tracy Walker and most of our secondary has had a really, really good week. And overall, Dan Campbell is just running a very efficient, very smooth, but very, very competitive OTA training session that is going to help this Lions team be very competitive on game day and be ready for the Niners in week one. All that being said, that is all for you guys today. Thank you all so very much for watching the video. Let me know what you guys think about this second week of OTAs. Let me know what you think about these takeaways down in the comments below. How do you feel about Jared Goff? How do you feel about our new secondary? How do you feel about Dan Campbell's approach to the OTAs? And of course, let me know anything else that you would like to see about these OTAs or anything else that you'd like to know down in the comments below. And of course, I will be back tomorrow with some more Lions content. With all that being said, that's all I got for you guys today. Thank you all so very much for watching. And until next time, and as always, go Lions!